If you have your Bibles as a word in the book of our Lord's Gospel as recorded by John, come with me to the 9th chapter. And please center your attention on verses 1 through to verse 12. For the sake of context and reference, that entire chapter says in context as of what this feeble presentation will be about, I will pick up at verses 35 through to verse 38 and stop there. And once you shall have found that passage and read it there, you may see these words. We commend those of you who stand to give honor to the reading of God's word, which reads as follows in the New King James Version. Now as Jesus passed by, he saw a man who was blind from birth. And his disciples asked him, saying, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" Jesus answered, "Neither this man nor his parents sinned, but that the works of God should be revealed in him. I must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. The night is coming when no man can work. As long as I'm in the world, I am the light of the world." When he had said these things, he spat on the ground and made clay with the saliva. And he anointed the eyes of the blind man with the clay. And he said to him, "Go, wash in the pool of Siloam." In parentheses it reads, which means sent. So he went and washed and came back seeing. Therefore, the neighbors and those who previously had seen that he was blind said, "Is not this he who sat and begged?" Some said, "This is he." Others said, "He is like him." He said, "I am he." Therefore, they said to him, "How were your eyes opened?" He answered and said, "A man called Jesus made clay and anointed my eyes and said to me, 'Go to the pool of Siloam and wash.' So I went and washed and received my sight." Then they said to him, "Where is he?" He said, "I do not know." Verse 35 reads, "Jesus heard that they cast him out. And when he had found him, he said to him, 'Do you believe in the Son of God?' He answered and said, 'Who is he, Lord, that I may believe in him?' And Jesus said to him, 'You have both seen him, and it is he who is talking with you.' Then he said, 'Lord, I believe.' And he worshiped him." Turn to your neighbor, left or right, shake a hand, tell them these words, "Neighbor, it's a setup." Now praise him for what he's getting ready to tell you. It's a setup. Though it may not appear as such, though most times it would seem as though God is aloof, out of touch, unconcerned, and uncommitted towards our cause. But I'm a living witness, I'm a standing trophy, that God knows what he's doing. His actions at times seems far-fetched, ludicrous, insane, preposterous, absurd, crazy, backwards, which never makes sense. But I'm a witness, and I believe I'm looking into the eyes of so many others who are witnesses themselves and or yourselves, that God knows what he's doing. I don't know how God does what he does. The capacity of our cranium cannot comprehend the logistics of the Lord and the means and methods and measures and manners by which God makes ministry out of miracles which were once a mess. But when it's over, we can conclude that God knows what he's doing. He adds by subtracting. He multiplies by dividing. He gives by taking. He raises you up by pulling you down. He puts you ahead by putting you behind. He gives you sight by making you go blind. He brings you alive by killing stuff off. It may seem crazy. But he knows what he's doing. And in so doing, God entices his own glory. In so doing, God has a way of getting praise out of your problem. God has a way of making Mary come out of your mess. God can get glory out of your gloom. God can get a shout out of your suffering. God can get a testimony out of your trouble, because God entices his own glory by involving Christ in your crisis. And then and only then can we, Sister Bailey, make sense out of our suffering. Gather gain and galvanize and glean some reasoning and rationale as to why the children of God sometimes have it rough. It is the only means by which we can get some perspective as to why the people of God sometimes have to encounter pressure, peril, plight, problem, and pain. And since you don't believe it, I've got some backup. I have a ready, right, and resourceful and replete reference. It's tucked within John chapter 9, which presents to us a quintessential case and a perfect pattern and paradigm as of how the Lord can take what doesn't look like glory and bring glory out of it. Oh, praise his name. And he did it by giving sight to a man that was born blind. And in so doing, he brought light into the otherwise darkened world of a man who lived in complete darkness and who thereby ultimately opened the spiritual blinded eyes of all who stood around observing and who would encounter the same experience. Because truth be told, many people have active optic nerves in the over columns of their cranium boasting with 20/20 vision, but they can't see. Are you praying with me tonight? They can't see how to love, can't see how to give, can't see how to forgive, can't see how to be happy, can't see how to appreciate, can't see how to appreciate one another, can't see anything about religion, can't see anything about salvation, can't see how to love a woman, can't see how to appreciate a wife, can't see how to honor a husband, can't see how to accept religion, can't see how to embrace salvation. Their eyes are open. but the blind. And there's only one I know that can open your eyes to help us see. And of all that the Lord wants us to see is that even though all sin leads to suffering, all suffering is not because of sin. It's a setup. Are y'all listening to me tonight? God has a way of turning things around, and the stuff that made you sigh is going to turn around and make you shout. The stuff that made you hurt will eventually make you happy. Can I tell you how? Can I tell you how you can discern and see that you've been set up? When you see your case, your crisis, and your condition, and interpret that as God being aloof, away, out of touch, insensitive, tasteless, tactless, and insipid towards your circumstance, if you're going to see it, I need to remind you from the outset that God gets his glory in that he set us up for celebration, because your dilemma has a deadline. Write it down. Write it down. I know you're saved. I know you're sanctified. I know you're spirit-filled. I know you've been blood-bought, blood-washed, blood-cleansed. You're heaven-bound. Your hands are wrapped up in the wine and chain. Your feet have been set on the glory road. You know the word of God from kibbeh to kibbeh. But I need to tell you, even though you're sporting a pseudo-halo over your head, I need to remind you that even God's folk have some trouble. I said, even God's folk. You go to church every Sunday. Let me help my boys on the corner. You're at the church house every Sunday. But everybody has some trouble. Do I have a witness here? But here's your praise point. The old wood floor church used to sing, the one without carpet on the floor, cushion on the pew, shining chandeliers from the ceiling, stained glass windows, powerful PA systems, and terrific preachers that were pristine in their education. They said, I'm so glad. Help me preach tonight. Trouble don't last. Get this. It can. But since God wants his glory, and he knows that we can't hold up and hold out and hang on too long, he won't let it last too long. Therefore, we can sing glory and thank God that trouble won't last always. You're not feeling me. All of us have trouble. Trouble sits on every king's throne. Trouble is in every queen's quarters. Trouble travels on every traveler's interstate. Trouble is in every pilot's cockpit. Trouble is on every pilot's ship. Trouble is in every teacher's classroom. It raises its hand and says, I'm present every day of school. Trouble is pronounced dead at every coroner's office. Trouble is in your house, your address, in your zip code. Trouble is where you punch the clock. Trouble is even where you raise your hand and shout, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. Trouble is everywhere. But thank God that our trouble has an expiration date. Dr. Carter, I don't know how long this young brother, how old he was, but the Bible says, John says, he was blind from his birth. He'd been putting up with his trouble all his life. Don't have a witness here. But oh, happy day. His trouble revealed its deadline. Can I tell you how your trouble comes to an end? Verse 1 tells me that it's because the Lord comes by. It opens by saying, now as Jesus passed by. You're going to have to stick a pin there because Jesus had just been expelled from the temple. When I get to verse 38, you're going to find out why. Don't have a witness here. But I need to tell you before I get there, the reason why you got out of the mess that you got out of, and the reason as of how you're going to get out of the mess that you're in, is only because the Lord has a helpful, holy, heavenly habit of coming by. You're still not feeling me. Many people are still stuck in this stuff because they have indulged and have condescended to corrupt methods and measures in order to bail themselves from underneath their burden. And to get themselves from underneath their gloom, they've tried new eyelashes, they've tried new fingernails, they've tried new toenails, new highlighters, they've gotten Hanes and Donna Karen, they've gotten the J. Renee's and the Jimmy Choo's and the Veer Spiegels and the Pumps, they've gotten that bob and the flip and the feather head. They thought that moving to a new house and a new hood, sleeping on a Simmons Sealy and insert a perfect sleeper with a pillow cover, they thought maybe that getting a new man, Maybach, Mercedes, money, and a mansion, that all things would turn around. But nothing's going to happen until Jesus. Can I get ebonic for a minute? You don't mind if I get ebonic? Ain't nothing gonna happen until the Lord comes by. And the reason some people are standing now, waving their hand now, and witnessing now is because they are recipients of the Lord's perusal. Won't he come by? I can't hear too good. I said, won't he? Pass me not. Oh, gentle Savior, hear my humble cry. While on others thou art calling, do not pass me by. He'll come by. I said, he'll come by. I don't know how long you had to deal with your darkness, your dilemma, your desolation, but I do know that the divine will take a perusal in your immediate proximity. You don't need black cat bones. You need him to come by. You don't need Ouija boards. You don't need mojo hands. You need the Lord to come by. You don't need crystal balls. You don't need a gypsy to read your hand. Do I have a witness here? You don't need to run up your phone bill and dial 1-900-PSYCHIC and 1-800-TERROR-TALK. You need the Lord to come by. You don't need bunny tails. You don't need wishing wells. You don't need rabbit's feet. If it didn't help the rabbit, it won't help you either. You need the Lord to... You want to know how I know it has a deadline? It's not only because he'll come by, but he'll clear up your record. Talk to me, somebody, if you can. When Jesus saw him, he wasn't the only one. The disciples cast their eyes upon the blind man, and they raised the question of Jesus embarking upon a cultural phenomenon or mosaic moray, believing that the iniquities of the fathers visited the children unto the third and fourth generation, so they attributed his condition to the corruption of his own biological connection, and asked Jesus, who did sin, this brother or his parents? Jesus said, let me clear the record up. You're not feeling me? You may not realize it, but the person sitting next to you has a record. They haven't been at the E.K. Bailey conference all of their lives. They haven't been shouting and doing holy dances all their lives. Everybody in here has a record. You may not have situated your hips and moved with illicit gestures and gyrations while the DJ was playing your favorite song, while the night lights were flashing and blue lights were flashing, but the person next to you did. You may not have vested your tongue with some vulgar and violent and venomous and vituperous vocabulary while in conversation with somebody else, while giving them a piece of their mind. You didn't do it, but the person next to you did. Don't sit here and try to pray holy on me tonight. I'll call your name. Take your halo off and hang it on the nearest nail, because all of us in here has a record. But thank God that the Lord disallows anybody from holding us hostage with our history. He cleared up our record. Romans 6:23 says, all, that's your name. It's not on your birth certificate. The health department forgot to put it on there. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Job put it this way. My witness, I don't think you're there, is in heaven. And my record is on high. Whatever others might say while rendering a commentary on my condition, I need to remind them that it's a setup. Because whoever wants to render some observation as of what my record entails, the Lord clears up my record. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Dr. Carter, it has a deadline. Not only because he comes by, and not only because he clears things up, but I need to tell you that it has a deadline, because he's gonna create a cure. Are y'all listening to me? Verse 7 says that Jesus spat on the ground. Verse 6 says he spat on the ground and made clay. Put it on the man's eyes. Actually, Jesus was embarking upon a remix for rediscovery. You know, this hip-hop generation, they have cuss words for lyrics supported by a beat and a background lyrical expression from old school, which embraces a new generation as well as those of my and your era. But in all actuality, it's a remix. And while there are others who couldn't quite get with the beat in days now antiquated, dubbed as old school, may quite and rather and readily embrace it because of a new beat with some addendum to the lyrical expression. Be it as it may, it's a remix. Jesus did in John 9 the same thing he did in Genesis 2. Do I have a witness here? He took dirt made dust, took dust made a man, took a man made a woman, took man and woman and made every man. But between that time and Johnny 9, there may have been some that didn't quite get with the beat. So he did a remix and took dirt and put dirt on dirt and made dirt seeing dirt. God knows how to do a remix. Anybody here know he knows how to do a remix? Whenever he heals again, that's a remix. Whenever he opens another door, that's a remix. Whenever he makes a way out of no way, that's a remix. Whenever he picks one up and turns them around, that's a remix. Anybody here got the beat yet? Look down your row and see if there's anybody on your row that's got the beat yet. Watch this. Because until you get the beat, if you really want the cure, he's going to have to take you through some dirty stuff. You miss me. He spat on the ground and made mud and put it on the man's eye. And until we get to beat, the Lord has to take us through some dirty stuff. I know that we can now boast and celebrate our participation in the patriotic process, but there was a day when a guy named Jim Crow said you wasn't going to be where you are today. Your mom and your daddy were brought over on slave ships across the Atlantic, dropped off on the East Coast, sold as chattel slavery. You don't know who your kinfolk are. Do I have a witness here? But look at where you are now. But to get you there, God had to take us through some dirty stuff. I know now that there's somebody of a certain significance of melanin in his skin sitting in the White House right now. But started out with an African daddy, white mother, Arabic name, rookie senator, now sitting in the White House. But to get there, he had to go through some... You're not feeling me. I said he had to go through some dirty stuff. Through the likes of a Rush Limbaugh who can get on public radio and say he hopes the new president would fail, not realizing that if he fails, America fails. If he fails, the whole nation fails. Do I have a witness in this place? We've got to deal with some dirty stuff, beloved. I said we've got to deal with some dirty stuff, even with the House of Congress that could support a dummy for 8 years as president and then fight a scholar in his first year as a president. You got to deal with some dirty stuff. There are some preachers who came to this conference tonight trying to learn out and discern and discover as to how to get through the dirty stuff. Because when they leave here tonight, they're going to have to go back and deal with their own personal dilemma. But if you hang in there, I'm going to quit in a minute. A little while longer, God got a way of getting you through you. He said, go wash in the pool of Siloam. The Bible says he went and still couldn't see. Sometimes, if you can't see it before you see it, you ain't gonna never see it. If you're gonna get through your dirty stuff, you got to follow the Lord with blind faith. Oh, praise his name. And when you get there, your testimony will correlate and synonymate with the lyrical expression of the writer that said, trouble in my way. I have to cry, help me. Sometimes I lay awake at night, but that's all right. I know Jesus will fix it. If not right now, maybe tomorrow. If you hadn't worked it out by tomorrow, I'll hang in there till the day after. If you hadn't turned things around by the day after, I'll hang in there till next week. If you hadn't worked it out by next week, I'll hold on to next month. If you hadn't opened the door by next month, I'm going to stay with it until next year. And if you hadn't turned it around by next year, I'm going into after wild mode. Shake somebody's hand and tell them I'm in my after wild mode. I'm going to wait because Jesus will fix it after. Thank you. I hear you say it's a setup. I tell you this and I quit. It's a setup, Dr. Watson, because our deliverance will soon be on display. There are some people in this room tonight, they've been through it. They've had to drink tears for water. They've had to climb uphill with a load on their shoulder. And while there are others whose theme song is Home on the Range, where the deer and the antelope play, where hall is heard, a disturbing word, and the sky is not cloudy all day. They don't have a problem, don't have any care, don't have any crisis, never been sick, never had to go to a funeral home, never had to sign a death certificate, never been laid off of a job, never been handed a pink slip. The eagle flies every Friday. They married into the best of families, married the sweetest of spouses. They walked into their promised land. They never had to walk through the wilderness whatsoever. They are pastoring some of the most wonderful people and never a hellraiser in the picture anywhere, but everybody in the house can't say that. They know what it feels like to make a nickel and have to spend a dime. They know what it feels like to take one step forward and have to fall back three. They know what it feels like when the medicine can't master the malady. They know what it feels like when you can't find anybody to have a shoulder to cry upon and everybody cried on your shoulder. But I've got news for you. When God turns this thing around, after bringing Christ into your crisis, he'll put your dilemma and your deliverance on display. Watch this. Jesus said to him, go wash. He went. The Bible says he came back seeing. You miss me? Let me hit reverse. Try it one more time and I'll get you out of here. When he washed, his pupils and retina began to have fellowship one with the other, and the light rays bounced off of external objects through the transparent lenses of his eyeballs, whereon there were nerve endings which caught the signal and the sign and translated them into neurons, sent them to the association cortex of his brain. His brain, through the process, even though the objects came through his eyes upside down, the optic center in his brain turned it right side up, and what once looked like it was upside down appeared right side up, and he said, I got to go back. Whenever he received his healing. Now, if you've ever had any experience with anybody blind, the senses that they have over against the sense that they don't have, they make up with the senses that they do have. Do I have a witness here? For a blind man, their ears become their eyes, and they have to be sensitive to every step. And my experience with the blind has led me to experience the fact that they count their steps so as to relate their position as opposed to their objects that they've left and to where they are going. This brother had to count some steps if nobody guided him to get to the pool of Siloam. So all he did when he got back, he was looking, but he was counting. Talk to me, somebody, if you can. And the Bible says he went back to the same place where he received his healing. Some people can't get back. Can I get a witness here? He went back to the same place. He went back to the same people. But when he went back, he wasn't the same person. I wanted to talk about all three, but I can't get there. I can't tell you, however, he went back as a different person because he received what the Lord wanted him to have. Can I tell you an experience I had once? I was in a bank once and I quit. I saw a little boy in the floor playing with some Legos. And his mother was in the service area. And suddenly she came out of the service area and she had a gallon Ziploc bag, and she kneeled to the floor and started scooping up the Legos and started putting them in the Ziploc bag. And he started jumping up and crying and screaming. She said, what's wrong with you? Now, of course, you know this wasn't a sister. Don't try that on a sister. That's Bad way to negotiate. Candidate for death row. She said, "What's wrong with you?" He said, "I made a man and you messed him up." Dr. Charles, she sat down on the floor and she attempted to put the pieces back together, but he wouldn't stop crying. Little fella just wiping his eyes. He wouldn't stop crying. She said, "Well, what do you want me to do?" He said, "Give him back to me." She said, "What you gonna do?" He said, "I want him like he was." The reason Jesus came in the first place is because he wants us like we were. And he wants us to see him for who he is. Oh, praise his name. Anybody in the house been changed tonight? God put your deliverance on display. And the same people who called you beggar, blind, God has a way of saying in front of those who counted you out a long time ago and said you wasn't going to make it, stand there and watch you make it anyway. Do I have a witness here? God has a way of making those that said you wasn't going to amount to anything, stand there and watch you make a comeback and prove to the world that the Lord can take you up, turn your situation around, and make you a public testimony that he had all power. You're still not there? Let me ask you a question. Do you have any rivers that seem to be uncrossable? Do you have any mountains that you can't tunnel through? God specializes in things that are impossible. I'm a living witness. He can do what no other power. Shake somebody's hand and tell them I'm on display. You don't know what I've been through. Do I have a witness here? Somebody here has come through cancer and chemotherapy, but you're still here. Somebody here, you've been counted out a long time ago, but the Lord delivered you. The Lord made a way for you, and you're here tonight, and how dare you cease from giving witness to the word and works and will and ways of God. God put you on display. When he wakes you up in the morning, you're on display. When he puts coal on your back, you're on display. When he put a covering over your head, you're on display. Can I get a witness? He came back seeing. Oh, praise his name. He came back to the same place. Came back to the same people. But he did not come back the same person. And because of that, he had to come back, beloved, and give a report. He had to come back and give a praise report. Same place, same people, different person with a praise report. We are admonished in Scripture to praise God. This young man came back to the temple, and when he arrived back at the temple, people noticed that he was not feeling for walls anymore. He was not in a daze anymore. He's matching voices with faces. Do I have a witness here? When he expose his deliverance, somebody raised the question, is this the one who sat begging as a blind man? Others answered and saying, it looks like him. Others said, it can't be him. And he finally spoke up for himself and said, yes, it is I was blind. But now I can see. If nobody else knows your story, you ought to be able to tell it yourself. Do I have a witness here? I heard somebody singing, blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. I am an heir of salvation. I've been purchased by God. I've been born of his spirit, and I've been washed in his blood. This is my story. This is my song. I'm praising my Savior all the day long. Is there anybody in this house that ready to tell your story? They raised the question, how did you receive your sight? He said, a man named Jesus restored my sight. Oh, praise his name. That's a theological rationale. In your praise report, as of how you made it this far, is because of a man named Jesus. Is there anybody here who knows who he is? His name is Jesus, Lily of the Valley. His name is Jesus, bright and morning star. His name is Jesus, way out of no way. His name is Jesus, true vine that will never wither. His name is Jesus, light of the world that will never blow out. His name is Jesus, he is the way that will never go wrong. His name is Jesus, he is the resurrection that will never die. His name is Jesus. The I am that I am, the Alpha and Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. Anybody in this house really know who he is? You ought to call his name Jesus. Hallelujah for the Lamb. His name is Jesus. Oh, praise his name. It's a setup. And the reason I know that it's a setup is simply because my deliverance has been on display. Oh, praise his name. And my dilemma, oh, praise his name. Oh, praise his name. My dilemma has a deadline. But I need to tell somebody it's been a setup. Because all of my doubts, oh, praise his name, have been removed by the divine. Oh, praise his name. When this young man said Jesus had given him his sight, the Bible said they put him out. But about that time, Jesus came by again. Oh, bless the Lamb. Because if there's anybody who understands your dilemma, the Lord understands. He understands your dilemma. Because he was not the only one that was put out of the temple. You must remember. Remember, they put Jesus out in John chapter 8. They put the young man out in John chapter 9. But I'd rather be out with Jesus than to be in with somebody else that don't know who he is. Shake somebody's hand. Tell them I'm hanging out with Jesus. He gave me my sight. Oh, praise his name. There was a day when I had doubts about who the Lord is. But one day, he erased all of my doubts. And I can say to somebody, you can't make me doubt him. I know too much about him. You can't make me doubt him. He's done too much for me. I know who he is. He ran him to Jesus. Jesus asked the young man, do you believe in the Son of God? He asked, who is he, Lord? He said, you're talking to him. The one you're looking at, he is the one who is the Son of God. He said, Lord, I believe. He bowed down on his knees and started praising God. That's all I got to tell you. When the Lord erases all of your doubt, oh,
praise his name, you will see that first of all, the Lord comes back. Oh, praise his name. When the Lord left the temple, oh, praise his name, he stayed in the general vicinity and came right back by where the man was. The first time he came, the brother couldn't see him. The second time he came, his eyes were wide open, but his mind was still closed. Thank God that Jesus comes back a second time. You ought to be praising God by now, because if the Lord had not come back your way a second time, you wouldn't be here tonight. You ought to thank God he came right back. He stayed in the general area. He came back another time. Anybody here know he'll come back again? Oh, praise his name. He'll not only come back, but he'll hold a conversation with you. He said, do you know who it is you're talking to right now? Who is he, Lord? I'm he who made a way out of no way. He bowed down and worshiped. I wonder if there are any worshipers in the house tonight. If the Lord made a way for you, if the Lord came back by your way, if the Lord had a conversation with you, do you mind praising his name? Can you worship God for who he is? He worthy. He worthy of all of our praise. Psalm 100 says, make a joyful noise unto the Lord. All ye lambs, serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he that hath made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving, and into his court with praise. Be thankful unto him and bless his name. The Lord is good. His mercy is everlasting. His truth endureth to all generation. Is there anybody here ready to praise your God? If you know he's worthy, shake somebody's hand. Tell him you've been set up. Whatever it is that had you down, God's going to give you a shout. You can praise his name. He's worthy. Yeah, he's worthy of all of our praise. I'll leave you when I tell you, the late E.V. Hill tells the story of a church member he had. He saw her walking home one day, and while she was walking home, he saw her take a few steps, and every step she would take, she stopped in every few steps. And after every few steps, she'd throw up both her hands and throw her head back. He said he watched her for a little while. She'd take a few more steps, and then she'd throw up both her hands and throw her head back. She'd take a few more steps, and then she'd throw up her hand. He said, finally he pulled over, and he asked her, what were you doing? He said, what do you call yourself doing? She said, Reverend, I'm on my way home. Oh, praise his name. But every few steps I take, I think about what the Lord has done. I have to lift my hand and praise his name. Somebody in this house tonight, on your way home, you need to watch your step. Oh, praise his name. Anybody in this house ready to take a few steps right now? Somebody right now, you need to get out of your seat and take a few steps, because every few steps, he's opened another door. Every few steps, he made another way. Every few steps, he picked you up again. Every few steps, he turned you around. Ah, he's able. Yeah, he's able. Anybody feel like praising? Put your arms around somebody. Pull them in real close. Tell them, hang on in there. A little while longer, he set you up to shout a little while. Yeah! He won it!
Subscribe to Brother Rollins Videos for Christ on YouTube. We post brand new content every week with powerful preaching from ministers and pastors all across the nation that seek to encourage people all over the world through the word of Jesus Christ. You will also find gospel songs and old-time hymns that have inspired generations of Christians. Subscribe today and hit the bell so you never miss new content. YouTube.com/Brother Rollins. Spell it B-R-O-T-H-A Rollins. Brother Rollins Videos for Christ on YouTube.